All right, thank you. Yeah, so if we can get moving on, I wanted to start just. If I could have everyone's attention. All right, thank you. I know it's, I don't want to stop the conversation, but we also have to get moving on our evening. Before we get started, I just wanted to mention here, if you get a chance to swing by before you leave this evening, Jason Thorne has brought up a map of, this is the city's nodes and corridor strategy, and actually it's a map of where that intensification that he mentioned just before the break is planned to go across the city. So it can give you a really good picture of just where those concentrations of infill development are supposed to go. So by all means, come by and take a look before the evening's over. But I'm very pleased in the meantime to introduce our next speaker. John Van Nostrand is an architect and planner and the founding principal of SVN. He has extensive experience leading large and complex regional planning and development projects across Canada and around the world. He's a recipient of many awards, including the World Leadership Award for Town Planning, the American Planning Association's Daniel Burnham Award, the UN Habitat's World Habitat Award, the Jane Jacobs Award for Ideas That Matter. He lectures at Harvard University, University of Waterloo, University of Toronto, University of Cologne, and Columbia University. He has a deep connection to Hamilton, which I know he will share with us tonight. We're very pleased that he's available to share his thoughts and insights with us this evening. Thank you.
I'm a walker also. Until I stop getting nervous, but I'm thrilled to be here, and even more thrilled that we got to speak together. You know, I phoned Richard 20 years ago after I read The Unplanned Suburbs, and I said to him, Richard, this is the most important book I've read on planning in Toronto, which is all the beginning of his talk here, what was going on up to 1950, where he pointed out that somewhere between 40 and 60% of all houses were owner-built in that whole period in various parts of the. And he said, oh, it's just history. I said, no, it's just great stories. And I said, no, it's not. It's really, really important. You and I should book the Workers' Museum, and we should have an exhibition about owner-built housing. And we had that exhibition in 1999, I think it was. And it was about Toronto and Hamilton. That's partly my fault too, because my mother was from Hamilton, but my father was from Toronto, so I grew up in the Queen-E. And, and I wrote a history of the Queen-E, actually. but they are fundamentally different places. And thank God. So I'm gonna talk tonight about a piece of work that I've been doing that was getting to the end of it. I don't think it's quite officially finished yet, but it then started some other thinking, so I'm gonna end with where that might lead. So it was funded by, and I have to thank them, I don't have the list of all the people who've helped me, but the Hamilton Community Foundation, and the Young family via the Hamilton Community Foundation, and then that also linked into Evergreen, so we worked a bit together with Evergreen. But also I insisted that we also work with the city so that what we did had some credence and it had to go through the system as it is. It wasn't just some kind of theory. And we started out by doing a lot of, being asked to look at a lot of planning issues. And this was, we were interested in the whole waterfront, you know, those big projects that talks about. I also do little ones, but we were interested in the whole waterfront. And the city said, oh, well, it's really important. You look at the West Harbor. And it needs some real planning input. And then I found out, well, actually, there's been a heck of a lot of planning. It took me about a year to find out there's been a heck of a lot of planning in the West Harbor. And Jason, or the city, said, you know what would be best would be, because I said, you know, I think the planning's sort of there. Or you've got to work with it a bit. It's really the zoning that's not there. And that's what you really have to, I'll talk about that a bit, but the zoning, you know, development is I go to City Hall, I look up the zoning, and I apply for a building permit. It meets the zoning. It's not about doing planning at a secondary plan level. That's important, that starts it off, but the real nitty-gritty is that action. And that's the action that's most important to me. Anyway, they asked, the city said, well, look, what we really need is for investors to come here, because we've got Bart and Tiffany, and we're doing this thing on the piers, and we need a guide for investors. And that is actually what we did prepare. But our argument was, in the beginning was, well, the first reaction was, we don't do that kind of work. People are really good at it. You have an economic development. But then I realized, oh, if I go back to Richard and his work and my own thinking in it, I said, well, I came back to the city and said, well, actually, the developers, the people we call developers, they're investors for sure, in about the top 35% of the population. But all the people live here are developers, because look what they're doing. They're building all kinds of things. And if you look at how this grew up, you see that many of these people were rooted here in that activity. So to me, they're developers. And then there's the builders, who are somewhere in between, people who become builders and help owners and help developers too. So the investment guide was for all three. And I wanted to share that. Just, I have presented a couple times, but just wanted to give a kind of overview of that and see how that links into intensification, because I think that Richard, again, is ducking, he's deferring to history to say adaptability. He means adaptability when a whole bunch of new people come and want to live on top of you, and probably should, because otherwise they're going to live out of Innisfil or the Greenbelt or wherever. So this is a key part of our history, and really, to me, intensification is just the history of cities. Great cities intensify. They always have. And you, one aspect of, and you adapt along the way. So the investigation, the intensification, sorry, the study of investing was to say, well, who invests and what are they investing in, and what do we learn from that? And then that seems to have triggered some idea of what could development really look like in that area. Next. So that was the cover. And I have to say that this has not been approved by council or anything. I've discussed it with the city, and they're interested. I still have to go to the subcommittee, I think, for we have to go. Next. So there are really five principles came out of the work, to start at the end first. But first of all, just what I've been talking about, the key being that the guide is for all investors, including current landowners, builders, and land developers. Because I think land developers are, I mean, it's kind of insidious that we call them land developers now when we all did it, or we all used to do it, or we're still doing it. But anyway, it's for all the people who develop land. Next. Planning for growth and change should be based on zero displacement of existing populations. So easy to say, except by choice. If you move out, that's fine. But if you're there, we have to deal with that. And I think that's adapting and makes sense, but it's not easy. And displacement is a very serious issue. Richard got into it. I don't know all the figures that he does, but a lot of people are displaced. They're displaced a long way away, especially if they want to own, and then they're moving, and their families are suffering, if not other people. Next. Number three is the city needs to co-invest. So the city's an investor as well, because it has to invest in the public realm. Because we're all right with building houses, running stores, starting businesses, but we don't do social, the public realm, we don't do the infrastructure, we don't make the regulations. So they have to invest as well, not just, and your city's done a pretty good job of investing so far in the West Harbor in the sense of preparing sites for big investment. Next. So the guide seeks to ensure that increasing land values, so there's now, the land values are not just that they're increasing normally. There's also a GO station in the middle of the West Harbor, and huge investment in that. And that will drive, it is driving in part, the land prices up as well, because everybody knows they can get to the GO and get either from there to McMaster or Stony Creek or Toronto or goodness knows where there in the future. So the value goes up in land, and the question, I think, the big question for all of us is who benefits from that uprise in land value? You know, the transit people like to say, well, it's just people within a 10-minute walk, and they're the important people for the transit. And I think the real impact is on the land prices and where they go up. And that's the catchment of that investment. So this says that we have to worry about the people who are there increasing land values that benefit them as well as the people who are coming. So it's a dual role that we have to address. Next. And then zoning, just that we need simpler, clearer, facilitative zoning to help us do what we can do in the best way and with the best conscience. And we don't have it. It's very, not just in Hamilton, but anywhere. I mean, I thought it was interesting when we went to prepare a zoning map here. I was embarrassed, but the planner kept saying, well, it's there, it's on the web. It wasn't on the web. It took 3 weeks to piece it together. And we made or reconstructed the zoning map for the West Harbor. And that means that most people really don't know what the zoning is. So at the very least, to know the zoning is important, because even if you do decide to sell and move out, you know what your land's worth. You know, one of the planners in that exercise said, oh, the real estate people really like this idea. And I said, they all know what the land's worth. They tell the buyer, not the owner, not the seller. So let's let the seller make the decision. Next. So why an investment guide? What's the purpose of this? Next. Sorry. So it's, you know, just first of all, and part because of the, but only part, but if it could, an ever-increasing part, it's because of the GO station that's opening there and the pending. So there'll be, as we'll see shortly, it's poised for major growth and change. I guess you'd say it's already undergoing that. And again, this is nothing new, as Richard said. We've had three periods of macro immigration. And just to set the context going forward, our growth plan for 2016, the larger regional one, points out that we're going to grow from 9.5 to 13 million people in the next 25 years. The larger picture is that Canada will grow from 35 to somewhere between 50 and 60 by 2050, and 100 to 120 by the end of this century. And that's largely 60 to 80% immigration. We're not growing. First Nations are growing. They're the only part of our existing, but it's immigration. So this is 1915 again, or 1946, or 2016. And we have a big opportunity, or not, before us. Next. So the West Harbor is proposed also to increase in overall population to accommodate its 40% share, its share of the 40% of the growth, associated with the being in the neighborhood and with the GO station. I don't mean 40% of all the growth is going here, but it has to share in those two 40% figures. So it's a double issue, because it's both a node and in existing neighborhoods. Next. And then just to say that at this point, or at that point, the relatively few development-led projects have been put forward to date. However, there's lots going on in the neighborhood. And these are just, you know better than I do what's going on there, and it is incredible. Somebody asked before, I think earlier, about what about what's going on without us knowing about. And it shows up in a recent figure which says that for the first time in the history of Toronto, the value of for every dollar spent on new housing, and you can see the amount of money that's been spent on new housing, was surpassed by the amount spent on additions and renovations. It was $1.15 in additions and renovations. We haven't had a chance to look at that in Toronto, but we did a plan for Regina, and we found it was 1 to 1.5. And the only way you can calculate that is on by going back to building permits. So what they mean is people who build renovations and additions with building permits are already out building new building. But the reality is it's about $3, $4, $5 that is happening, being invested, because all those people who go to Home Depot who's not suffering in the least are not developers, and they're not going with a building permit. They're going to accommodate people, many of them, in all kinds of not very nice ways, because that's going on as well. It's being taken up somewhere, all of this, and we try to pretend we don't see it. Next. So it is important to us, and that was a question that came up too, that because people kept saying, why are you down in the West Harbor? And we could say, well, the city said we should go there. But I don't think wherever you go, I think it's just the beginning of a whole of a series. Well, it's actually that map, I guess. Just there are a map of areas which are very similar. They're going to grow. They're going to intensify, as Jason's just pointed out. So the idea was to approach it in a way that can be carried over into those other areas when the time comes. Next. So I'd say the heritage of intensification, which is just Richard's story up to about here, this is one block in the West Harbor, which became a significant block, but we looked at a number of just what happened between in that block between 1890 and 2000. But what do we, well, we don't know what's going to happen here, but we know it's there. So it's just to say that change, that is always something that's going on. The only period it didn't go on was about 1946 to 1970, when immigration changed from being just people from the UK, largely from the UK, who were allowed to build shacks, and because of course they were Irish too. They would improve them, and they did. But when the immigrants started to become from Bulgaria and Italy and Czechoslovakia, Poland, places like that, was a different story. So we got to get out of the city and move out to where, you know, I don't mean, that's more the Toronto case here. It was just people making a lot of money and they were able to get out. Get rehoused in the new housing, or reshopped, or re-industrialized, or whatever. That I think is something that I would recommend striving for. Next. So the planning and zoning frameworks that we're dealing with that are in place, working with, is one is set and sail, which is actually now the secondary plan for. The West Harbor, and as it exists, so that's it. And then there's the zoning, which I'm saying, which is, there's a little bit of a disconnect, just because this is about 1958, 1958, 1960, and this is today. So that's normal, but there has to be, and I think the city's already beginning to address some of this, but that's an important updating as well, because it will frame create the densities, the built form, et cetera, that will house, continue to house you and house new people. Next. And then I just underline the fact, planning framework, we consider this as part of the planning framework. These studies that were done as part of the planning framework, as does Metrolinx, as does the city. But, you know, so we're working with those as well. Next. So the question is, where is investment going to happen? And the setting sail plan creates three areas that I think are the ones we're dealing with.
First, there are areas of major change. That is, when major change is going to happen, that is, I think that equals density means, new things that house lots of people will sort of be there, or there. There are then the corridors along which the transit runs, so those usually change as well, either in a planned way or an unplanned way. And then there's these large, so-called stable neighborhoods, which are already changing. So they're not so stable, really. I mean, they are stable because of changing. Next. And so that's the kind of graphic, just, and you're welcome to use this, but we also created a 3D model of the whole area, just so we can see what the stuff looks like that we're proposing or you're proposing. So there, that's just a 3D model of it, and talks about, so there are the three areas, Barton Tiffany, Pierce 7 and 8, the sort of hospital area. The blue are the corridors, Barton, Cannon, James, and the GO station, and you can see the green is extensive investment in public realm here as well, for the whole city, not just for this neighborhood. It's there. Next. So we looked at those zones and just made a sort of a little pie chart of what's what. So about 30% of the land is currently public realm. 17% of the land is the areas of major investment. The corridors, the land affected by the corridors, we go to the back of the parking of the property lines, is about 7%. And then the stable residential is about 46%. Next. So where to invest? I'm not going to go through these. We know about these ones, and two are on their way, and you've had all kinds of input into them already. So those are the areas of major investment. Reinvestment. Next. There they are again, just a reminder. Next. There's, and this tells you also what the population they're going to accommodate is, which is important. Because we're looking to get 12,000, I think. So we're going to get 2,000 in Barton Tiffany. That's an estimate. I'm not sure. It's not mine. Next. And we're going to get another 2,800 in Pierce 7 and 8. And we're probably going to get another 2,000, I think, in around the hospital. Dwelling units, not just. There are jobs as well, which is a really interesting whole other talk about why have we been calling since 2006 density is people and jobs. We don't count the jobs. And actually we're involved in challenging that argument because the notion in the beginning, and Jason would know better than I do because he was sitting there in the whole time, but with people and jobs had to go together. But there's still not. There's lots of people stuff. There's no job stuff. It's very limited. Put it along 400. Well, we can't get to 400. We'll put it on there. So, next. So that looks, there's a miscalculation here, I think. But there's 16,000 additional persons that are going to come to this area. Those three are going to give us about 6,800. And then, yes, that's right. And so there's about 6,800. There's about, most people are going to live in 6,800, so there's 9,200 other people that are going to live in this community outside of those large areas, which is about 58%. Where are they going to live? Is sort of the question you started to ask. Next. So we looked then to the corridors. Those are the corridors. And we started to look also at zoning, the existing zoning. I mean, we did say the city, you know, and the city actually is in the whole process of zoning. It's a very difficult process, zoning, and you're in the process. We just hadn't quite got here yet. But so there are the corridors. Next. And there's a notion that's come out of the hub study that was done here that this should be, you know, used in mid-rise kind of guidelines that the firm who did the hub study developed in Toronto, which have been sort of interesting. We worked with them actually on the Eglinton subway across the city. But we actually came to the conclusion that this is a very difficult thing to do Because in order to build those mid-rise buildings, you have to demolish everybody's there.
Yeah,
we're talking about that. And that means that you have to assemble the whole block to do it effectively. You have to assemble a whole block to do it. And I can tell you, if developers are the only people doing that, that when they get to when they get it assembled, they're going to say, we need more than three stories. We need six or seven or eight, which may be an option. Maybe you'll say, well, that's okay. You know, I mean, the restaurant, which is building now, they're building seven or eight, so that's great. The restaurant on James just... But we were always interested in this, at this point, saying, what happened on these corridors before they were planned like this? Next. Just to give you a glimpse of that, oh, it's just like the houses. Oh, it's just people took... This is actually in my neighborhood, so I know the store, and I couldn't go back beyond 2007. But these were four different stores with four different owners. The restaurant came in and bought the store next door, but the owners kept the upstairs apartments for a while. Then they bought my barber, or not bought, but went into partnership with my barber, and he's that healthy barber, or what's that guy's name? No. He was my barber. And then they actually built over, this didn't happen at one shot, it happened, first of all, Spiga kind of took the ground, then they built up to there, and got a few new apartments and some offices, and then the last thing they did in the last few years is do this. So it was just indicated to me, hey, this happens the same way the housing happens, and isn't that what's happening here already? So why don't we take a look at how do we help what's already happening, and who's wanting to invest in there, to show them what the potential is. Next. So we looked at we did more with this, but just give a chance. This is also to James Street now. Next. And this shows just what we call an elevation, looking at a whole block. So these are the existing buildings. And these shapes here and the colors are actually what the zoning permits right now. So actually, you could, and the zoning may even change and get higher, but you could actually, all these people could double their size, at very least. And they could do that on their own, they could do it with their neighbors, they could do it with a whole block, the people who are there now, or were there. Because probably people who sold there didn't also realize this when they sold. But that's the story of where it is now. So we're saying, well, corridors of gradual change, which I think Senator Sale said, means corridors where people develop it as they're doing already themselves. And maybe they bring in builders, maybe they bring in developers, but that's their call. Next. So finally we looked at the stable residential areas, and this is all short-circuited, but so there they are. And now we're curious, well, what is going on here? I mean, we see all this building, and we see people adding floors, and you see new people coming in and building the soldiers, you know, because they're actually building tall, thin buildings like along the edge of a park, where the schools and the community center are. Next. We looked at three areas in detail. We've looked at more since, and I'm not going to make any kind of, I'm not going to misuse, I don't know if these situations exist generally. It looks like they do, but I'll just show you the one we looked at here. Next. I'm sure, I know somebody is here who lives in this neighborhood, but let me use it as an example. So there it is now. This is Ferry and Mary Ferry, that block. And so there it is now. Next. That's a closer look at it. Next. And so this is the opposite of, so Richard's brought you up to where it is now. So it was always changing. And those earlier diagrams I made were of this block. But that's what the zoning allows here, and up against what exists now. So this is a bit startling for people who live there, but it's also interesting because it opens up a discussion of possibilities Because all of those houses are somewhere between 40 and 70% completed. They could all add one or two units, in other words, or work at home place or whatever, and do that today. And I think we found out at the meeting when we presented this down that neighborhood that people had no idea that was the case. And yes, the real estate agents know this, but I don't think people do. So we're just saying, you know, there they are, there's an opportunity. So now we've got these opportunities at three levels next. This is just sort of details of that. There's a funny zoning here that if you add a family to your house, it changes the zoning a bit, but it's still the envelope is 14 meters high, which is actually very large three stories, or four stories, actually. I asked, actually, city, what about if you build four stories and that was permitted, and they said, well, that's a minor variance from three to four. I said, great, I would be doing that. Some people are already doing that. Next. So there's the block that exists, there's the block, just redoing it. Next, that's the sort of more graphic version of what it looks like. Next. But then you get into this. So, where would you put that addition? What could you do? Am I going to take on, because I think I may, a lodger, as they were called, because they need to get to the train station, and they need a place. They can't afford to build a new house. And I could move into that. When I first went to Toronto, I lived on about 10 minutes walk from the Eglinton Station on Oriel Parkway, which looks like very grand houses, but they're all full of rumors. And we got to know the families. And so it's a,
You're done.
I will be done. Thank you. Next. So this leads me to sort of speculate, this is not the city, not the Hamilton Community Foundation yet, what I'm working on, that we could really look at turning those early plans into growth plans at a neighborhood level that you help create along with the city to make the kind of decisions that have to be made about this density, questioning this change. There's a growth plan at a regional level, which nobody really knows. But that plan to me only makes sense, and it's a very, very good plan, if it has meaning at a neighborhood level. And so far, it's a failure. It's just gotten rid of everybody. It's done very well for the top 35% of the population in tall buildings, and it's displaced everybody in its wake. And I use a different word than Richard. I'd say economically displaced, because they have been. Social displays, or whether it's direct or indirect, but I think he's right. There's a whole variety of reasons. Next. So, just what I said, there's a big growth plan, but then we get down to the city plans, and then we get down to this. These are missing. These are sort of half in place because cities were required to do a growth plan. There's one done in 2006, there'll be another one done. And then this is the neighborhood which. And I think all those three have to be in harmony and working. Next. And there are other things going on around where people are beginning to look at neighborhoods. Actually, Toronto's beginning to look at neighborhoods. They don't call it a plan, of course. It's just character guidelines. So it's a reaction to every neighborhood who's afraid of displacement, saying, we're a historical heritage district. We can't do anything here. The list got to 55 neighborhoods in the city, and the city said, we've got to do something. Hey, let's talk about, and we're part of this, talk about character guidelines. So, this is, and those kinds of concerns. Next. But here's an interesting one in Parkdale. They have their own plan already, but they've made it themselves. They're not a dissimilar, actually, neighborhood to what we're talking about in that. There are more rooming houses there than there are in your neighborhood, but this is what brought people to the meeting. Next. And these are their concerns. What about height? It's community financing. What about food? What about affordable housing? So that's their focus as a community, which you then have to put together with the ones the city wants you to worry about, heights and that kind of stuff, and look. Next. But then it struck me, and I was talking earlier tonight, to say, well, you've already got some principles going here. I mean, I'm sure these are refined, these are very old now. I thought they were still pretty good, and I just took out, what are the principles that you're working, all those people who did raise a hammer thought you should be working on. There's another whole layer there. They're sort of complementary, but if you put these all together, you'd have an incredible neighborhood, or neighborhoods. And next. So I just try to, I'll end with just trying to show you the options in as simple a way as I can. So if you took that pie chart and made a graph, and said 30% public realm, 45% stable residential, 7% corridors, and 70% areas, just as a sort of graph, a pictograph, next. So what about we say 100% of all the growth will go in the major areas only? That's the 12,000 people. Well, you'd have 28 12-story buildings or 14 24-story buildings in those three areas to accommodate that. It could be different forms, but we know what you want, which is 8 stories and low, and that's what's planned there. So, but then that didn't get accommodate the need. I know he's not here tonight, but I'm sure that what's his name? Dutch guy. Would be Herman. Yeah, thinks he got to stop at 16. Next. Then we could easily show, and on a model, this is just a graph, but if you're taking this properly, you sort of show what it actually looks like across the model. What about if we put 25% in here and 75 here? So we still haven't touched you, but that does mean that these are going to go up to 8 stories. Probably will be more than owners can deal with, but who knows? And you're still going to have 7 12s or 11 24s. Next. So I think you get it. What happens when we say, well, 10% of the growth will be in here, using those as a right abilities? The Paris has a great plan for intensification. They just said every dwelling gets to add another dwelling unit, 440 square meters, which is a one-bedroom apartment. Every dwelling. Well, of course, you can't do that because it's buildings. And so now all the people in the buildings get together to figure out how to enlarge their own building to do this, to capture that. Or how to change those little barracks up top, if we could make them bigger because people can afford bigger now. So it's about a three-page plan. And I think, once you could be saying, well, we think that 20% of the housing should be able to add on a unit, is what we're saying. So et cetera, et cetera. Next. These are not solutions, they're just showing you in a really crude way what's before you, what the options are, and what to begin to think about if you haven't already. Next. So just ending here, I think that working with intensification, work with intensification is not the enemy necessarily. But not against it. Because you're just working with history, you're working with cities. If you don't work with it, we're going to have more sprawl, all those other things that we don't want to know about, but they will happen. Intensification really equals growth and change, and adaptability, I'll add now. Understand and learn from the history of the growth of Hamilton. It's been a process, not a project. It's happened at the hands of people, city councillors. So it's the argument is intensification is good if you look at done in the proper way, might be better than urban renewal, because that wasn't very good for us. And in fact, set the city back. Plan for intensification for your neighborhood, your district, your city, not just your region. Create jobs. Building is the biggest economy we have. In Holland, they have a law that says everybody over the age of 18 is entitled to own a home. I said, what are you doing? This is ridiculous. He said, no, that's our biggest economy. Building homes for 100% of our population. which means they're building, 40% of them are building their own homes. So it's a huge economy that we're, it's not just developers are doing what they're doing, they're also taking that economy away from us. If you think of building materials, all the associated issues. And learn from other cities in Canada and everywhere else, but really rely on what makes Hamilton happen. That's what's really important. Yeah, you can know, I got this from Mayor Bloomberg. He said, we got our trees from Copenhagen, we got our bike trails from Paris, we got this and that. He said, but this is New York, so we get this way. And they have all those things, but I think this is the key. Next, one last thing, don't forget that this happened. Because I don't, because I was alive when that was happening, and so why did I do what I'm doing? You can't rip a whole heart of a city up and expect to recover that in two generations or three. But we got a really interesting opportunity now. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that. I think we have time for a few questions. Okay, I see a question there. Sure.
Can I ask two questions?
Okay, two quick questions.
The first one is, I saw that the slide about public investment, you're equating that with the city of Hamilton. So I'm just wondering, it's kind of unfortunate that school boards and schools aren't figuring into that.
Oh, I actually used the word there. The Liberal government, first government, and now they kind of hide it, but it said, well, the infrastructure, the public realm is infrastructure.
Right.
It's social infrastructure, roads and bridges, and economic infrastructure. And there's half budget infrastructure for those and housing. So public realm is not just making the trees, like making it look nice. It's actually the whole level of servicing, the facilities, the schools, the parks, and so on. Everything we don't do, that they...
It seems like there's a disconnect between all the intensification that you're talking about, particularly in the Barton Tiffany corridor, and the school board plans for possibility of school closure in that area. There's already a high school closing right in that area at the end of next year.
Well, I can tell you that we just bought a vacant school in Toronto, a vacant English school. That's what will happen. You know, actually, going to Holland, I went to this new neighborhood, which is large neighborhood, but not only, they plan a whole town for 40,000 or 50,000 people, like three dimensionally. And then they reduced it down to a survey. It's on the ground, like just, and then you could buy a little lot, like 5 meters by 60 meters, or you could buy 10 meters by. You could buy different sizes of lots at different heights. And then they had a list of builders and a list of architects. I don't know why they need an architect for this one. And everybody built their own house. I'm talking about like bungalows, row houses, and the city said, well, great, but we'll just do the school and the shopping center. And they said, no, we'll look after that. So they built this building that is a school, but it's also the main theater. It's a mosque. It's I don't even know how to describe it. It's everything. As a start, it's like a starter social service. It's a hub, yeah. And it'll grow. And then the commercial, instead of the shopping plaza, they just built a market, almost exactly like St. Lawrence Market. And except it's open all week, you know, and that's where you focus on. So it can be done.
So is that being built with the plans for Hamilton?
I think it's not new thinking, and I'm sure that you've got some pretty interesting people there. I think you've got to also have some tools to actually show what are the options. Not just learn about developments at a statutory meeting, and it's all too late, and maybe just whip around they can go around the city. The city can be all for it or against it. Anybody can go to the OMB and overturn it. So, but the only way you're going to overturn it is to decide you have a stake in it. And we're not going to let that happen. And that takes You are developers and you do this with planning.
Just a quick question about zero intensification. I really like that principle, but I mean, how does that actually work? If prices are going up, housing prices are going up, what the property taxes are, like, how do you actually put that into place?
Well, there's no question that that's a difficult thing. It never has happened particularly. But I think that you could give people the options. For instance, if I am currently talking with the city housing people, that public housing project, say they're moving to the mountain, but now they have people moving in back in other places, parts of the neighborhood, which I think is good for the neighborhood. And it's like all these new things. So what am I saying? I think you have to talk about that. I think it's quite possible people do it. Everybody, all those people we aren't housing are starting now. I mean, some of them on the street are minor compared to the number that are in 13 units in the basement up on the mountain. And there are many of them. And they're living in rough shape, and somebody's overcharging them and making money on it. So why don't we just out it and say, let's provide for this in a way that brings them into the economy and makes them part of it. I think if we don't, if you've got 80% of the population as immigration over the next 25 years, and we don't embrace that, we could be in serious trouble. More trouble. More poverty. More poverty for sure, because people quite a little more.
So you mentioned about intensification, homes. You touched something on jobs. How does zoning or intensification planning look into the employment factor? How can we kind of bring that in? Because we're talking a lot about housing.
Well, yes, housing is a big thing, and we're actually quite interested in housing as well. That's another lesson. I think the ways are, first of all, I think we're going to go back to where we recognize that labor helps you own. Renting helps you own, but also doing it yourself helps you own. It may not be yourself, it may be people that are in the neighborhood who have the skills to help out and accept it, because there's a lot going on, and I can do it myself, or I set up a business for building materials, or I set up a business for helping. There aren't that many different housing types. Maybe as a standard, but there already is a pretty standard. You add a floor there, pretty standard stuff. So those are all economic activities that I think. Then you have the fact that 10% of people already work at home. That's a known fact. Do we do anything about it? No. Are they illegal? No. What are they doing? Well, why don't we just embrace them? Say, well, what can we do at home? Oh, what can we do in the neighborhood? Oh, what can't we do? What do we have to go across the street, across Burlington Street to do it? And think about that, because it used to be that all those things went on. I lived beside what was a dairy in the middle of town and all kinds of other things. So I just think we've got to put up my thinking is, like if I was doing that, I'd do a skilled inventory and say, who's here? What do we do? Who's on employment? Hey, let's get together and we need your help at my house. And there'll be new buildings as well. And the new buildings should be a way, I think, that encourage, allow you to rent out space for someone to help you own it, encourage you to exchange it over time, etc.
And those are major social changes in thinking for people to accept a dairy beside their you know, prime rural conditions and all of this makes it very difficult. People have all different, those same communities are all different individuals with individual dreams, if you wish.
Sure.
And so.
Yeah, no, I'm not, there's no rosy picture.
Right.
It's just that we used to do, as Richard was saying, up to the end of the pay stop, we used to do. There are no mortgages either in that period. Think of it. What's if they went to the bank or did that stuff? You went to your church or your cultural center. I think it's, I'm saying, I hope I'm careful about it. You know, high interest, low short-term loans. And so, and then somebody was British, came and said, in 1950, oh, we've had it with the old city, you know? Get away from the go-as-you-grow city, where the lot next door, you could become a gas station overnight. But tear the downtown down. It needs urban renewal. Tear the whole of downtown Toronto's supposed to come down. One-fifth of it was taken down. That's called Regent Park. That was supposed to be the whole thing. And get out of there if you've got any, you know, if you can afford to, get out of there. And go and live in a place where and leave the rest to what is turned into poverty. It's pretty, I don't think there's some kind of like other version. I'm just trying to, and we're learning it slowly, and we have options. And if we don't have options, we're gonna be, that gap is gonna lead to more violence, not just more.
I have a question about the intensification, and you cited a lot of figures about growth is happening in the downtown. And do we have, but we kept talking about how many people do we, and I'm also concerned about the number of schools that are being reviewed. If you don't have a school in your neighborhood, you're not going to be attracting families into your neighborhood for one thing. But when you say that, say, 16,000 people are going to be intensified over the next 20 years.
I'm going to say that's one of the...
Can we predict how many of those people are kids? And can we also ensure that that happens by asking developers or by mandating or zoning developers to put in a number of residents that they're gonna accommodate families so that it's not just one bedroom, like we were talking a lot about one bedroom or adding additions. That's adding singles. How do we ensure that we're gonna keep families down here?
I think.
And therefore our schools open.
Well, schools will. People will open schools.
We're locking and closing them.
No, I know, but people will open them. We got a lot more private schools now because, and they aren't all rich private schools, they're just schools because our kids are in school. And the government sort of tolerates that. But I would think that you could maybe take the school and figure out what's needed for it now, but also realize it's probably going to be a school again. If you can have that. So not. And Toronto, which is looking at every city, looking at the same thing, they end up waiting so long that the school needs to be open again.
But how do we ensure that the market has housing for families and not just has all the families living in the outskirts, and then downtown is just for retired people and
I don't know the Hamilton story, but developers pay cash in lieu of providing those services. Or they do it through development charges. Cities meant to provide them, but they don't, because they've got tons of other things to do before you know it's gone.
Is there any cities that are doing that?
I'm sure there are. I can't see them. And I'm in difficult territory here, but I think it's not an insolvable problem.
I think we have time for one last question. I see you've had your hand up for a while.
Back to the school board situation, I'm just curious if you have any thoughts about where ordinary people could intervene or make a difference. Clearly, the town is a prime example, but it's all about the province where trustees and senior officials and school boards have no concept or insight of urban planning or projections. Where could ordinary people intervene to make a difference?
Well, I don't, actually, this is exactly, that approach I was talking about in the school of Toronto, we're addressing that by saying, I think, first of all, when it's public property, it has to go through about 30 other public agencies. Who can all express their interest in it. And then it goes to the city. That's how it is. And so, but if you went to the city, I think you have to get together, think about how you use that building, what the purposes of it, what don't you have to do now, what can you use it now and protect it to be school again, and go to the city and make the case. And the city can say, well, okay, you're next on the list. Some of those people come. Actually, it's sort of interesting if you
listen to all those people, they all want something, but they don't want a whole school. They don't want it at all. And then you have some other uses that aren't, we don't have a Aboriginal drop-in center here, we don't have Aboriginal population, whatever. So you gather those things together, and you look at the school settings, you say to the city, if it gets through those people, we're ready to do this.
But that suggests that the school would leave and cooperate with the city.
They're just smart parts, you know. They're just guessing. We're guessing at what the politicians are. Guessing it's all going down and it's all going up. So they're caught now. They're firing other people. They're all this stuff. What the hell is going on? But we certainly. I had a professor in architecture. So changed my life. He said, the first day of the, I actually wanted to go to history. He said, of all the buildings in Canada, 7% of them are architects. Very helpful. And he said, well, you know, you've all been living in buildings for 20 years. You already are architects. You just have to turn those glasses on. I don't know my lungs and my pancreas. If I turn them on, I'd be a doctor. So I think it's just a, you've been living in these places. You know them better than anyone. That's a very powerful thing. I'm not fully overthrowing agencies and governments, but you know them. And that's why you're there, and that's a very powerful thing. Most of the world, 80% of them, builds towns like that. They don't have a choice. And so I know it's quite possible. And I've seen that in Holland doing it, and I've been doing it. So. And you did it. You and your ancestors did already up till 1950, and they started to say, oh, no, get rid of all those houses on Ferry Street, put a park in there, and, you know better than they do.
This is the part of the evening that makes me sad, because I feel like we could keep going for another hour, but unfortunately it's after 9 o'clock and we do have to call it tonight. I wanted to thank John and Richard Harris for being here. And I'd just like to invite Maureen Wilson to come up and make a few final words.
Suffering from that crisis, but one of the facts surely is that it has become a segmented, fragmented nation. And fragmented nations are built on fragmented cities. And what I saw tonight in some of the graphics from Professor Harris and from John was that we are becoming fragmented as well. And the dangers of that are becoming evident elsewhere. Cities and how they plan and grow, there's no neutrality. These things are by design. Choices that we make, or if we fail to show up. But the promise is that we can rebuild trust at the community level, at the association level, and by knowing our neighbors. And therein lies the importance of the built form, how we associate with one another, the beauty, and the difference amongst us in our neighbors. If we have immigration is going to account for 80% of our growth, we have an opportunity to enrich our neighborhoods as opposed to segment them. That's my political commentary for the night. I hope you will join us in June for a different subject altogether, where we will be talking about women and the city. Tomorrow is International Women's Day, March 8th. I hope you'll be wearing red. What if our city had been built for women and by women? Would it move differently? Would it feel differently? Would it smell differently? Our cities were designed for men, by men. What needs are particular to women now that are not being accommodated, that are being accommodated, that could be accommodated better? I hope you'll join us June 6th. I think we'll be at Mills Harbor. Thank you so much for coming up. Thank you, John.